Hi everybody, this is Gijs again with another review and I hope you are doing well. This time it's a backpack, the Fjällräven Singi 48. And if you are looking for a sturdy, sustainable backpack that also looks the business, watch this video. Welcome to the review of the Fjällräven Singi 48 backpack. And welcome to my little piece of forest as well in the Netherlands. And this is really a nice spot. Can you hear them? It's a couple of birds of prey that are nesting over there. And I think it is absolutely nice to hear. And I've been watching them before I went here. Now, let's continue with the Singi 48. I've been testing the Fjällräven backpack now for about 5 months, just before Corona hit the Netherlands and the rest of the world. I had some time to do some serious walks with this, and in the Corona time, the last 3 months, I've been using this basically on day and weekend hikes in the Netherlands, but I've got quite a bit of experience by now. The reason why I requested this backpack to review is, well, because on the specs, I probably thought that I would like this backpack. And I never tested a backpack from Fjällräven before, so that's why I requested it. Now let's continue with the materials and the weight of the pack. It should be no surprise to you that the Singi 48 is made out of Fjällräven's core material, which is of course G1000. And in this case, it is the heavy duty Eco S version. Now, for those who don't know this, G1000, it is a mix between 35% of cotton and 65% of polyester. And because this is the eco material, it is recycled polyester and it is eco cotton, which I think is absolutely good. What you also should know, and most people don't know this, and a lot of people in shops don't tell you, is that like hard shells, rain jackets, rain trousers, tents, also the material on a backpack has a DWR coating, and DWR, durable water repellent, means that if you get a drop of water on it, it basically rolls off so that the material itself won't get wet. Now with the DWR coatings, the sturdy ones, they have got this PFC material inside it, and PFCs, they are very harmful for nature. Especially the C8 ones, the C8 chains, you don't see them anymore almost, but some C6 are still used in hard shells. But Fjällräven uses a PFC-free DWR coating, which is of course very good for the sustainability of the pack itself. Now, and that is what I also like a lot about the packs, and also about materials and products that Fjällräven makes, because they do a lot about sustainability. The weight, I put this one on my precise scale and I weighted it at 2161.2 grams. And that is about 61.2 grams more heavy than the weight that Fjällräven claims, because they claim a weight of 2100 grams. Now I must state that I measured the weight without the rain cover, which is I think about 130 grams, and without the side pockets, because the side pockets, when you buy the Singi 48, they don't come with the side pockets. This is an optional extra, but more on that later. Now, one of the other things that I wanted to test, why I wanted to test the Singi 48, is because of the carrying system. Now, to show you the back system, I of course have to turn it around, and I'm very grateful that the sun has come out so I can show this into the sun quite nicely. Now, and here is the other thing that I like about the Singi 48 and about some other backpacks that Fjällräven does. That is the backbone. These two pieces, they are actually made out of wood, and I think it was birch wood, to be honest. And this is FSC wood, so this is also sustainable grown wood. And that's of course very good. The wood itself, it's treated with linseed oil, so that makes it less vulnerable for water or moisture. The back system itself, it is adjustable to the back length. And this is a backpack that only comes in one size, so the back length is adjustable from 34 centimeters to 54 centimeters. And with my back about 48, 49 centimeters, I'm sort of on the higher end, but it fits me very, very well. to adjust the height, basically, there is not really a measuring device on it. So this is a little bit of trial and error on how you feel the backpack on your back itself. It's of course between this point and the point of your shoulder straps. If you want to know how you do it, then read the article, because it's in the article on my website, and I'll put the link up there as well. One thing that I do not like about the pack is the way how to adjust it, because behind the big firm shoulder pad there is a buckle, and I can't show you it like this, so you will have to come and look from above. And when I lose it, that's the easy part, losing it. And now I can adjust it from, and now I have to loosen the load lifters, of course. I can lower it or raise it, and this works perfect. But now if I want to get the buckle, and this is of course the other buckle, that if you need to fix it on a different point, this is how you fixate it. Now what the problem is, and now I have to put it back in my position, is that the buckle, if you want to get it back in there, this takes quite some force, and it's not that easy, because you cannot really hold the buckle that's underneath here. And this is something that is a bit of a fiddly, not nice process. And if you're not strong in your arms, or you don't have strong hands, I think this might be a problem if you have to do it quite often. But to be honest, how often do you have to change your back length? Well, I hardly ever change it, because when I've got it in the right position, that's the point that I do it. And after that, I never ever change it again. So probably this is only a once in a couple of years that you have to do this. So in that respect, it is not a real big problem. The carrying system itself is very comfortable to wear. I've been using it a lot, and I like the fact that the shoulders, of course, they have got a foam and padding. Also the hip belt's got a foam and padding, and there is a mesh here so that sweat will get into this area piece and it will evaporate, which I think is of course good. But it is quite a firm foam, and I like this firmness, because you have got a really good contact with the backpack itself. Some backpacks, they are really have really soft paddings, and then you feel the backpack getting into your shoulders, and this is not the case with this one. What is, in my opinion, sort of remarkable, because this is a one size should fit everybody backpack, is that the hip belt itself, if you have the buckle, the diameter that you can change this from the smaller size to the bigger size, is the smaller size is 66 centimeters, and the widest size is 1 meter and 46 centimeters. So in that respect, it fits quite a lot of people. On the side of the shoulders of or the hip belt, you've got these two straps, and these two straps, they provide of course stability of the pack to the hip belt. They transfer weight, and they make also that the backpack is a bit more firm on your back if you like it, or if you need some more movability, more flexibility, then you can loosen them, which I think is absolutely good. The shoulder straps, of course, they've got load lifters. The load lifters, they are fixed on one point only, so they won't change between if you raise or lower basically the shoulder straps to your back length, which is not always good, because in the ideal world, if you have the load lifters, this now is, it's quite positioned high, this should be about an angle of 45 degrees. Well, of course it is not. In my use, it's proven not a problem, and that's probably one of the, I don't think it's a negative point, but one of the things that happens if you take only a backpack in one size, it's hard to adjust this. Now the shoulder straps themselves, they are very easy adjustable as well. As you can see, I've got the hose of the bladder running over the left shoulder strap, and there's a reason for this, because there is only one exit from the back outside the backpack. There's one hole, and it's run over the left shoulders in this case. If you want to do it on the right side, it's not possible. And I don't know, but I am right-handed, and for me the left shoulder is always fine, because then I can use it like this. But I can imagine that people who are left-handed, they rather have the tube going over the right shoulder so they can grab it like this. That's for you to decide if you think that's a negative point or not. But I think, well, it would have been nicer if they made basically two openings like on many other backpacks. Then there is one thing that is also mentioning worth mentioning. That is, of course, the chest strap. It prevents that the shoulder strap slides sideways. It's got the adjustability on the shoulder straps itself, and this is a slider. And sometimes this is like a slider on a sort of a tubey thing. I don't like them because it's happened to me quite often that it comes off the tube when you put some force on it, on the slider itself. In this case, it doesn't happen. This is a perfect slider. It will stay on one place if you fixate it there, and it will never ever get loose. What I asked my wife, she wore the backpack as well, because it's one size fits everybody, so it's a male and a female backpack, that you can see that, maybe I should take this one. The shoulder straps, they are quite curvy. And for me as a small guy, this is fine. For my wife, she with her breasts and wider shoulders, this was fine too. So in that respect, I think this is really a unisex backpack. And of course, for safety measurements, the hip of the chest strap has got a whistle, and that's what it should have. Also the padding on the lumbar supports and on the shoulders, I like it as well. And what you can also see is that this is a close contact backpack, because this is basically where the back goes, here as well, and here is some space. And this is quite a space where you've got some air running through. If it's a little bit warmer, this is quite comfortable. It's not a ventilated backpack in that respect, so it sits really close to your back, and in that way it is a very stable backpack. That's what I do like a lot. Now we're on this part anyway. You can see that there is a pocket on the hip belt here, and there is a other one on that one. There are two loops here as well, so you can put some carabiners on here if you want to attach something to it. Or if you break this one, then you can of course take a rope and tie it around here. I've noticed that the pockets are quite nice if you have a bar, like a Mars bar or something like it, or a gel, piece of chocolate, some candies. This is very fine. Don't put your smartphone in here, because if it's rounded, your smartphone will not stand the pressure if you bend it too much. It will break. It's big enough for a smartphone, by the way, but just don't do it. Now, I think I've covered everything on this part of the backpack, and now let's go to the other side. Now let's continue with the backside, basically, of the Shinji 48. And I'm not sure if you're liking this image, because I had to put a big reflection screen over there to show you in my dark forest a little bit more on the backpack. Yes, I like making videos. What you will see is that there are a lot of daisy chains on the pack. There's one row here, one row there, and then also if I turn it sideways, you will see that there is one row hidden here and one row hidden on the backside. Now, if I turn it around, then you will see that the daisy chains, they are always very convenient to tie a lot of stuff to. There's two on the top lid, by the way, as well. I use it for my Kupilka mug. I use it for knives and some other small stuff that I can attach carabiners onto. But Fjällräven did one really clever thing, and that is that they made some accessories. And this is, for example, the Shinji side pocket. And this is the Shinji, if I'm correct, gear pocket. And they are, and in this one, they are quite big actually. They give a lot of extra volume. You'll have to pay extra for them. Here is my Clean Canteen big thermos bottle in it. I did a review on that one as well, put the link up there. And these side pockets, they've proven to me to be very convenient. You don't have to put a thermos in here, of course. You can put a mattress in there, or if you've got something like a hammock or a raincoat, that will fit in there as well. They're quite big. The clever thing is how they've been, how they designed the way how to attach them basically to the backpack, and that's of course on the daisy chains. And the good thing is, on the lower part they use these little toggles, and they go into one of those daisy chain loops. But on the top, there is of course the same toggle. But what I really like is that the toggle, there is a little piece of rope again, a loop, that you pull over the toggle. And in this way, basically the whole pocket on the top part is secured, so you will never ever lose this. Now, good accessory. So if you buy the pack, there's always more possible. Then, you can see that there is a nice strap with a clip here as well. You can use this if you want to store, for example, a shovel or maybe some snowshoes in wintertime or whatever. And there is this bungee cord, piece of elastic band that I most of the time use if I put my raincoat underneath there when it's wet, or a towel when I've been using it. It's a good place to dry your stuff on. What the pack is actually missing is a dedicated trekking pole holder system. Most of the backpacks that I test, they've got these loops or cups that you can put the pointy part of the trekking pole in, then you've got an attachment system on the top, and that's what I do really like, and I miss it on this one. I use basically the compression straps on the outside of the backpack for my trekking poles. So if you have to put them here, they're not that easily accessible, but it's sort of, well, if you need it, you need it. That's the only thing that I think that is missing on the outside of the Singi 48. Now, this was all that I could tell you on the outside of the backpack, except for the fact that I do miss a little bit of reflection material. If you walk in the nighttime next to a road, and then you have to tie a headlamp to a cord or to the bungee cord or to the strap for safety reasons, but more on reflective materials later on when I head over to the rain cover. But now let's get into the backpack itself, and let's start with the top lid. The top lid, it is of course detachable, and it is detachable in this way, but there are also straps on the side, on the back basically, so you can raise it or you can detach it in total. What it doesn't have is in the top lid, it doesn't have a sort of a belt so that you can use it as a belt pack if you like it. Now on the top lid itself, it's got one big pocket on the top, and this is where I keep my sunglasses, gloves, some food, and this is also the place where you have a keychain holder. I saw that they attached the rain cover to it. I'll take it out to tell you more about this one later, which is of course good because then it won't fall out. But to be honest, a keychain holder, I would rather see this one in the pocket that is on the inside of the top lid, because this is basically the place that is more secure. People won't reach into it, and you will not lose things from this pocket easy. This is where I keep my passport, my wallet, that kind of stuff. Now, let's turn it the other way around, and then you will see that on the top there is this strap. This is a strap. I've got my hard shell underneath it. It is possible to put a tent underneath this as well, or a mattress. And this is the other part which I should show you. What is the case? The Singi is a 48 liter backpack, and with this extension you get a bit more. And the thing is, this is of course not the G1000 material, this is 100% polyamide. But this is the extra that they basically don't tell when you buy the backpack itself. You think it's a 48, but it is basically a 48 plus. And I calculated it, I think it was about 12 liters extra or so. Now, this is a top loader backpack. So that means that you put all the stuff in from the top. And I've got my pots, put them over here. Hammock and a lot of other stuff. I won't show you everything, but there is a lot of space in the backpack. So if you are going onto a hike for a week, this backpack is big enough. I've been carrying about 15 kilos max because I'm a small guy. I weigh 63 kilos. I don't need that much stuff, so I don't need to carry that much. So about 15 kilos in total I've been carrying, and with this weight the backpack is fine. And I can imagine that if you're bigger than I am, and you need more stuff, then it won't be a problem. It will get a decent, you can get about 20 kilos probably in the backpack without any problems in carrying it. It's sturdy, it's sturdy enough for carrying a big load. Now, what is something that was surprising to me, which I didn't know when I got it for the review, is that on the bottom there is a big zipper, and the zipper. There's a nice flap underneath it, so when it rains, it will not get into the zipper itself. And the zipper, it's a two-way one, so you can take it on both sides. It's basically the access from underneath. And also here is the polyamide to make the backpack a bit more waterproof when you put it down into wet grass, for example. This is where I keep my sleeping bag. There is not, and I will close it again. No, let me open it and I'll take my sleeping bag out. There is not a divider in the pack itself. So with a lot of backpacks that have a bottom zip for the sleeping bag, they have got this special compartment. So when you open this, the rest of the stuff won't fall downwards. In this case, it does happen. So that's why I will put it back. This is quite a big sleeping bag, to be honest. But still, I thought, oh, why should I have a zipper underneath it? It's not absolutely necessary. But in real life, it's proven to be quite practical, to be honest. Now, that's on the, basically on the inside of the backpack. I already told you that I have my bladder in here. For the bladder, there is, of course, also a attachment system so that it won't drop down. That works very nice. And the bladder, it's not interfering too much with the space in the backpack itself. Now, this is what I wanted to share with you on the pack itself. Now, let me get all the stuff in there again, and let's head on to the verdict. So, the backpack is packed again, but I almost forget about the rain cover. And this is really a cool thing that I like about the Fjällräven. Because the rain cover, it is blue. And blue, it is the UN nation color blue. And what Fjällräven tells me is that this color, I know it's very visible in a green landscape, which is good in case of emergency. But they also tell me that this is very, very visible in snow and icy circumstances, which I thought it was always blue. But when they said, well, let me believe them, because here in the Netherlands we don't have that severe winters anymore. And this is how it goes on. And it fits really nice. And what I also do like about it, it has a very big elastic band around it. So that means it is very well around the backpack itself. But also on the sides, it's got these loops, hooks. And with these hooks, you can attach it basically to the pack itself. And that means that if you've got wind coming from the side, there will be no wind blowing into the pack or into the rain cover itself. And also it will stay there a bit nicer. Now, what I said about the reflection material on the back of the backpack, the lack of reflection material, to be honest, the Fjällräven logo and the Arctic Fox, this is reflective material. So if you are hiking down a road in the middle of the night, just put on the backpack and you are going to be very, very visible. And now it's time for my verdict. If you listened carefully to my story, then you might know by now that I like the Fjällräven Singi 48 a lot. In the first place, because it is a very well-built, sturdy backpack. The materials, I like it a lot. And also because it is sustainable. The recycled polyester, the eco cotton, and also the wooden stays, the birch stays that are made out of FSC wood. I think if you can make a sustainable choice, well, this is definitely a sustainable choice. Yes, rugged. It's also a little bit on the heavy side. 2.1 kilos is quite heavy for a backpack own weight. What I also do like is that the 48 liters of volume for what I do, if you do head-to-head hikes or just a weekend to a week travel with not too heavy stuff, this is an absolute voluminous backpack. And what I am surprised about is that basically because of the extension, you get more space. And if you want to carry more loads than the 15 kilos that I used to carry, then this extension is really, really good. And 20 kilos for the carrying system and the backpack itself, it should be no problem whatsoever. I like the fact that it is a close contact backpack, because that means that the balance between my body and the backpack is always spot on. And that's something that is, well, proven to me that is very important to me, because if you are on a ridge or in a tricky path, a stable backpack is really, really important. What I think is missing on the backpack is a really dedicated pole, trekking pole fixation point. What I also think that they should have two openings for the hose of the bladder, one on the left side and one on the right side. And what I also do think is that the keychain holder, it should be on the inside pocket of the top lid, because that's basically the most secure place to store your keys. Now, the best thing about the backpack overall is, I think, the way how you can attach stuff to the outside. I love the daisy chains. And I also do like the extra side pockets that you have to buy extra if you want them. And I would strongly advise you to buy at least one. And if you buy one for the balance, it's better to buy two. Because what the backpack is also missing is basically a bottle carrier on the outside. And most backpacks, they've got one on this side or on that side. The Shinji 48 doesn't have it. But I don't see it as anymore as a negative point, since I've got these side pockets. And the side pockets, how they are attached, it's a really good system, and you can attach four side pockets in total. Now, there's one thing that is quite important, and that is, of course, the price. Fjällräven stuff is never cheap, and in this respect, it's not different. The Shinji 48 retails for €279.95, and that is quite a lot of money, especially because it's just a pack and not with the side pockets. But I think, because of the sustainability, it's worth every penny of it. And therefore, I rate the Fjällräven Shinji 48 at 8.8 points out of 10 total. I hope you liked the video and that it is useful to you. And if it is, then please give it a like and leave a comment below. And also, if you've got any questions or remarks, post it in the comment section, because that's what it's for, and I'm more than happy to answer everything. If this is the first time that you see one of my videos, then you might not know that I am a 100% independent reviewer. Manufacturers are not paying me for my reviews. And if you like my way of independent reviewing, then please subscribe to my YouTube channel, and don't forget to hit the alarm bell so you know when I uploaded a new video. And also like my Facebook page, and please follow me on Instagram. It really helps. And if you do, many, many, many thanks in advance. Enjoy the outdoors and stay safe. Ciao, ciao. And now I am going to go into my bag and find my tick remover, because I saw some ticks already crawling up my legs. And ticks and Lyme disease, I don't want it. So I better be quick. Hope to see you next time. Bye bye.